And the final piece in the jigsaw appeared when we met Simon, who's a friend of a friend, who used to sell tickets down at Uli, where we'd go and see gigs. And we'd tried loads of drummers before because we wanted a real drummer, but no one had fitted in at all. And again, with Simon, it was exactly the same as with Bernard. Within like 15 seconds of him playing, we all just knew he was completely right.
Always been my ambition to be a musician, pop star, whatever. You know, always, since I was four. I can't tell you how it went. This is my 13th band, but all the bands I've been in before, I just weren't. This is the first band I've ever played with that I felt completely 100% into.
I sometimes think, oh, it's so mundane and boring and average living in Devon. I can't wait to get away and do something a bit more positive, a bit different with my life, which is what Suede have introduced to me. They're not famous in an American film star way. You know, they've made it for themselves through their music. I don't think, you know, they were brought into a glamorous world, but they're definitely... I think it was so unglamorous for them that they've made the glamour.
Suede have affected Molly's life quite positively. You know, she's taken on quite a lot of their statements, and it's perfect because they open up so many topics of conversation for us. Somehow we've actually got closer, Molly and myself, through this, you know, and it's not just a crazy obsession with a band. It's they're more than that somehow. They're saying something about society today. Because we are. Because we are. Oh, we'll take the tides. That's the final.
Well,
if
you also
have been
there,
would
you
have gone
to Mayday
or come
up? No, we'll come up.
Hello.
Hi,
yeah.
We've got
Barney's out.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
Got dirty
hands.
You know what?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Molly had to sing, was it the next life in RE to a whole RE group?
Yeah. Did it then?
No.
Yeah.
So she did.
In front of the whole
and
class.
I sang the piano.
For RE?
Yeah.
She got her homework, so Mr. Roberts, our teacher, said you have to sing a Suede song.
So I chased the next life.
When you sang it in front of the
class? Yeah.
I was only seven.
Did you have to do it all with a full
setup? Yeah, I had to do everything. Although I stopped on the high bit.
I thought, Mr. Roberts sounds like a...
Well, I really feel quite inspired to write quite a lot of sadness, quite a lot of feeling of dislocation. And at the same time, the opposite end of the scale quite inspires me, kind of like a really kind of sort of searing, almost violent side to life really inspires me.
I like you. You're a white, tasty geezer. You're my mate.
The mates, aren't we?
We're one of the lads.
Whenever I write about people in dislocated situations, whether they're isolated, sort of you know, in where they live or what they look like or how they think. I always want it to be quite inspiring to the people that it's aimed at. And people always think of the traditional sort of view of heroic people is of either, is of kind of like sort of someone in the ghetto or something like that. And of course they're heroic as well, but people never really talk about some sort of housewife in North London, you know. And I decided to write a song about it, so I wrote Sleeping Pills about it, which is just about, I don't know, the sort of drama of the everyday, I suppose. I often write in as someone else, but I often write as just a human being, as just a spirit, and so I have the ability to be able to flit into other minds. And often when I talk about men in my songs, people assume that it's because it's got something to do with homosexuality, and it hasn't at all. It's much more to do with a spiritual perception of what being in these situations is all about, really. This ambition that you know, one day it would be wonderful if you know you can make kind of credible, kind of great music, you know, basically a kind of guitar rock, you know, traditional guitar rock music, but that people could understand on all levels. Ambition would probably be to spend all of our time in a studio. I really envy bands like REM and stuff that can afford to do that. That can just spend all their time in studios and not and play live if they want to, but it doesn't really particularly matter.
One time that we're at our most relaxed in a way is when we're just working on new material, because you just slot back into just being in the band and you don't have to worry about any of the nonsense, and it all comes ridiculously naturally.
Bernard sort of comes up with, you know, tunes. Sometimes they're completely fully formed. Sometimes they're completely got structure and got middle eights and something. Sometimes they're just riffs. And really, I just work on what kind of gives me that spark of inspiration, really.
Words never come into it at all with me. All I know is I've got music going around my head 24 hours a day. It's the last thing. It puts me to sleep. It's what I wake up with it. When I'm not talking, I'm thinking about it. And which is pretty sad, in a way, because it makes me very dull.
Committed, and you have to not see any point in any other life. Otherwise, you're not giving everything. None of us can act, or none of us can paint or anything like that. You know, I'm rubbish at everything else. Can't even change a plug.
Suede is here.
I love you.
Brett, you're charming and beautiful.
Thank you a lot, Bernard.
All right.
Who's this
big
guy? See, you're moving in with her.
Now, Brett's play is this enormous gig. This is the biggest gig we've ever played.
Brett, I love you. Don't ever stop singing. Come back again. Don't sell out.